Today, is our focus is on Gideons International, and we're thankful for the Gideons that we have had and do have. And so you may remember that Norval King beat that drum for many, many years and carried that baton faithfully. And we're grateful for folks like Norval and others. Current Gideons are Floyd Yoder and Bruce Johnson. And there's others also Liz, yes, sorry. So there's others of you that probably have served in the past, or maybe you are in your camps back home, and so if I don't know that about you, sorry. Any other Gideons that I haven't named, just slip up a hand. Boy, that's what you call a ripe harvest field right there, buddies. Some of you might be getting invitations to serve. I have a hit list of about 15 that I'm willing to offer up. Of course, you could always volunteer. That would be the best way. But they're looking for a qualified men and women of God. And when you hear today what the ministry entails, you'll be excited to be a part. And so it's good to have Chuck and Mary Smith and Mary's sisters with us this morning as well. We welcome you. And Floyd will give a proper introduction, but we would like for you to watch this brief video.
I I find this an exciting time when I can introduce my brother Chuck Smith and his wife Mary. Chuck is a businessman. He's been a Gideon since in 2001. He has traveled to India and Indonesia. He's been planting churches over there, and through this, he's able to also be a Gideon and spread the word as Gideons over there. If you will, please make Chuck feel welcome, and I'm so excited to have him here.
So does God have a sense of humor? How many says God has a sense of humor? Okay. Abdul was born into Islam in Ghana, Africa, and he dropped out of school at an early age. He fell in with a bad sort of fellows, joined a gang, and he became an armed robber. And his gang robbed the bank in Kumasi. And so he was caught. Most bank robbers aren't too good at it. And he was put in prison and sentenced to life in prison. And he was considered a dangerous criminal, so they kept moving him from prison to prison. And in one of those prisons, the Gideons came and distributed little New Testaments. And he thought it was great because those little pages in the New Testament were perfect for rolling marijuana cigarettes that he had smuggled into the prison, and he would sell to the inmates, make a little money on the side. And there was a Christian inmate that had converted from Islam to Christianity, and he was so upset that he was desecrating this Bible. He said, "You need to stop this wicked act." Well, Abdul just told him to mind his own business. But that night he had a dream, and he said that something that was like an angel spoke to him in his dream and told him he needed to stop doing that. And so he sought out that Christian inmate, and the inmate told him, "I really think that's Jesus trying to tell you to straighten up and come to him." And he took that advice, and but he didn't really do anything at that point. But that very night, he couldn't sleep. He just couldn't sleep. He was just troubled in his spirit. And so he thought, you know, I'm gonna go ahead and turn away from what I'm doing. And he packed up all of those drugs because he knew it didn't really matter, since he was serving life sentence. It didn't matter that you get an automatic 10 more years added to your sentence if you are caught with drugs in the prison. So he went ahead and packed it all up, and he gave it to the commander of the prison. And he began to read what was left of that little New Testament. And he found the Christ. He became a Christian. And he began to go to Bible study in the prison with this other Christian inmate that had tried to give him such good advice. Well, years passed, a couple years passed, and the president of Ghana was about to leave office. And much like our presidents here, when they leave office, they have the opportunity to pardon people. And he didn't really think much of it. Abdul didn't think much of it, because men who were sentenced to life in prison were typically not eligible to be paroled. So he was shocked when his name was added to the list and he was set free. Now, he needed a job when he got back to Kumasi, so he joined a security firm. And his first duty post was to be a security guard at that same bank that he had robbed. And at the end of his first day of work at that bank, they came and gave him the keys to the bank to take down to the police office to put it in the safe. And he's thinking to himself, "What is wrong with these people? What is wrong with this bank? I robbed this place and they're giving me the keys." Well, Abdul still works to this day in that bank in Kumasi, and he evangelizes to the lost there as well. Do you see the power of God's word? Okay, that was particularly lousy, I must say. That was the audience or congregational participation element of my presentation. And you did terrible, okay? And I'm going to be having you, this is going to be a two-way conversation this morning a little bit, okay? So I'm going to have to ask that question again. Do you see the power of God's word?
Yes.
This is working. That's good. The Gideons, most simply put, is a few men and women of the church taking the message of the church to a lost and dying world. We are an extension of Venice First Church of God, and our goal is to reach the lost. Our method is quite simple: personal witnessing. And oh, by the way, as we go, we do distribute a few scriptures. Let me ask you a few questions. Do you think it's important that when people visit Venice, there's a copy of God's word waiting in their hotel room?
Amen.
Okay, no. Remember, I reminded you, you're going to talk back to me here, okay? The answer, I saw a lot of people go like this, okay? Give me a little love here. Do you think it's important that copies of God's word are distributed in our jails and prisons?
Yes.
Do you think it's important that a copy of God's word is available at crisis pregnancy and domestic abuse centers throughout Florida?
Yes.
Do you think it's important that when somebody from anywhere around the world visits Venice, that there's a copy of God's word in their hotel room?
Yes.
And do you think it's important that copies of God's word are given to our brave military serving in the Middle East and around the world?
Yes.
Well, like any good lawyer, I only asked you questions that I already knew your answer. Last year, the Gideons distributed almost 98 million scriptures, but the demand was even higher. Organized in over 200 countries, territories, and possessions, Gideons around the world distribute scripture in over 100 languages at the rate of almost 2.5 for every beat of your heart. As you saw in the video, that says 2. That video was made 6 years ago. It's now 2.5 are distributed for every beat of your heart. Closer to home here in Venice, we faithfully service the hotels. And while that's the scripture distribution that you might be most familiar with, or perhaps that we're best known for, you may be surprised that hotel distribution represents only 7% of all the distribution we make worldwide. In fact, over 50% of our distribution worldwide is targeted at the youth and for the generation that we're at risk of losing. We also managed to hand out 325 scriptures from sidewalk distributions at Lemon Bay High School and Northport High School, and we're going back for more. We also distributed over 5,000 scriptures at the county fair last March, and we will be there again here in just a few weeks to distribute scriptures again. And then other recent distributions here locally include doctor's offices, nursing homes, and then we also gave over 600 scriptures to various outreach events that were conducted through the Salvation Army facilities. So as Pastor mentioned and how Floyd mentioned, that actually we have been involved in church planting, Mary and I, in India, in West Bengal, India, since 2006. And the Gideons have been such an important part of what we do, because in India, when you need scriptures, you just don't need a few. It's not uncommon to need 15,000 scriptures by Friday. And so being a Gideon helps out really well there, as we're able to typically go into Kolkata and find the scriptures we need, and they are immediately distributed. We distribute at colleges there, and we're given permission to go into the college and teach conversational English. And we use the Bible as the textbook, and we use a faith-based curriculum as our curriculum. And I want that to sink in for a minute, because I'm going to compare that to what happened in Indonesia here in a minute. But think about that now. We're actually invited to do that. You can't do that here. Amen? We were in one, this was a trip I wasn't on. Mary and our daughter were over there, and they did a college distribution. And a young man came up to the booth that we had, and he was violently opposed to what we were doing. I mean, he was angry. He was wondering, why are you coming here with this foreign religion? We don't need this. What are you doing here? You need to leave. Quit doing this. I want you to meet this same young man, Sagar Banerjee.
Hi, my name is Sagar and I'm from Bankura, West Bengal in India. And I'm belonging from a family where there is no any hope for life. And previously I was exhausted with my life. What to do with my life? I didn't have any purpose to do something for God. And one day I got to meet Taylor and Sister Emily in my college exhibition, Bakula Somuni College exhibition. And they were distributing Gideon Bibles there. And I got a Bible also. And next day I got to meet Miss Mary, my mom. And she was also there for distributing Gideon Bibles. And they were invited me for movie night in their house in Rampur, Monmouthor. And I went there and I saw the Jesus film over there. And I got to know how God sent His one and only Son in the earth and how He loves us. And from that time, I got so much question, and day by day I went there for Bible study and Bible classes. And there was thousands and thousands of questions in my mind. And they helped me so much to understand those questions. And after that, I got to get hope in my life, and I was starting to transform. And nowadays I am fully transformed, and my one and only savior is Jesus Christ. Thank you very much for watching this video.
A young soldier from Zimbabwe was deployed on a peacekeeping mission to the Congo. And his unit was ambushed by rebels, and 30 soldiers were killed that day. And this young soldier I'm talking about was actually shot in the chest. And he awoke as he was being medically evacuated, and he looked down at his chest to see the wound, but there was no blood. His pocket Gideon testament was in his pocket like this, and it had stopped the bullet, or it would have been a direct hit to his heart. Now, that young soldier's no fool. He figured that that was a pretty good book, so he started to read it. And he accepted Jesus before he left the Congo. Now, the report doesn't stop there. He returned to Zimbabwe, and he was standing for inspection, and the bulge in his shirt pocket was all it took to get him into detention. And at the next inspection, it happened again. And then a third time, finally his sergeant asked him, "Young man, why don't you just remove the bulge from your pocket?" And he proceeded to explain that it was this Bible that had saved his life and stopped the bullet in that ambush. And the sergeant quickly got a hold of the chaplain and he said, "Call the Gideons and get as many of those little Bibles as we can for all the men." You know, I've traveled in dozens of countries around the globe. And believe me when I tell you, we are the most blessed nation on the planet. And it's our responsibility to get the word to the lost. Recently, my Indonesian Scripture Blitz team of men, there's seven of us from the United States and Australia, because of your support, distributed over 113,000 scriptures in the most populous Muslim nation in the world. We did that in 7 days. I was able to preach Jesus even in Muslim schools. Again, we can't do that here. The principalities trying to control this world are trying to lock God's word out of our schools, but we are unwilling to accept this. And in fact, churches all across America are unwilling to accept this. So God has opened yet another effective way to reach the generation that we're at risk of losing. The Lifebook Movement is how the Gideons International, through youth pastors, equip their high school believers to be ambassadors for Jesus with a peer-to-peer distribution of a contemporary version of the Book of John, like you see right here, that even the ACLU has endorsed as a perfectly permissible distribution. Amen?
Amen.
Thus far, over 27.3 million copies of the Lifebook have been distributed in our nation's high schools. And the stream of testimonies that we are getting from lives forever changed from this book is incredible. They just keep building. So you have old guys like us standing on the corner passing out Bibles, or you have a friend say, hey, you know, buddy, I just thought, you know, this means a lot to me. I think you'll really enjoy it. What do you think will be more effective? I think God's pretty smart about this stuff myself. We also have the Gideon Bible app. We released the Gideon Bible app. It's free in the App Store. And I encourage you to get the Bible app. Well, why would you want to do that? You might already have a Bible app on your phone. But does your Bible app have over 1,200 languages of the New Testament? Does your Bible app have helps? Does it have the plan of salvation? Can you walk up to a Russian person? You know, I saw where there's a German service this afternoon. Imagine when you have a German friend visiting this area. We have a lot of Ukrainian, we have a lot of Russians here. And you can share the word with them in their mother tongue. I have to tell you, when you do that, it stops them in their tracks. And you have an opportunity to share your faith. You know, I have to admit, as Gideon, sometimes we don't always have a copy of God's word with us. I have to admit that. Case in point, yesterday, Mary and I were on Palm Island, and we decided to go down, take the golf cart down, and go to Stump Pass, where they're doing this dredging. I wanted to see what they were doing down there. We were in beach clothes. We didn't have Bibles and phones and all this stuff. And as we went down there, we met Big Mike, who was sitting in a golf cart. And we proceeded to talk to Big Mike, who was telling us about all his health problems. And boy, he has a lot of health problems. And he's going to have a procedure next week. And so we asked him, Mike, are you ready for that procedure? And he goes, well, I guess as ready as I could ever be. I said, no, I meant, are you ready if you don't survive that procedure? Because it's pretty serious what he's going through. Well, you know, what do you mean? Well, are you ready to meet your Savior, your God? And he goes, well, oh yeah, I'm good there. I said, really, are you good? He goes, yeah. I said, why is that? Why would God let you into heaven? And he said, well, because I'm good. And I believe in God. And I said, Brother Mike, if what you believed wasn't true, you'd want to know it, right? I mean, is that enough to be good and to believe in God? Because I'm here to tell you, my friend, it's not. And I said, just how good are you? Well, people would consider me a good person. And so I gave him the good test. And I don't know if you're familiar with this, but it's in the way of the master. And very, very quickly, none of us can pass the good test, folks. If I gave it to you, you'd fail just as miserably as Mike did. And he discerned when asked, you know, you're going to meet God soon. He's an elderly gentleman. Are you wanting to meet a judge or a savior? That's a choice you have. And right now, in your current condition, how's that judge going to pronounce you? And he said, well, I'm probably going to be guilty. Does that concern you? And it did. And we didn't have a Bible there, but he had a smartphone. So we were helping him get the Gideon Bible app up there so we could continue to share with him about what the Bible says about salvation. And right there, yesterday afternoon, Stump Pass, Cape Hayes, Florida, Mike prayed, surrendered his life to Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah.
It's the power of God's word. It's the power of God's word. We have also a program, which I was talking to the folks in Sunday school about this morning, called the Friends of Gideons. Friends of Gideons. There are some of you here today who may not qualify to be a Gideon for whatever reason. You may not feel like you could commit to such a commitment. There's a program called the Friends of the Gideons, and it's fabulous because there's a couple of different ways you can participate, but when you become a financial friend of the Gideons, you're able to purchase these little New Testaments at the same price we do. Now, the video talked about $1.31 a copy. These are now $1.25 a copy, and so a full case of these is $125, and you can buy different scriptures to take with you and give those as you go, just like you were if you were a Gideon. You would also be invited to many of our events. Pastor was with us at our pastor's appreciation banquet this past week, where I stole a couple of those testimonies, as you noticed. Even pastors are able to become friends of the Gideon. So we encourage you can certainly join the ministry, but you can also become a friend. So you're probably wondering, well, what is all this to me? What does that mean to me? Well, there's a number of different ways that you can support the Gideons. First and most importantly, you can pray for the ministry, and I know you do on a regular basis here. Pray that we'll be able to meet the overwhelming demand around the world for God's word. I can't express in words to you how much there is a hunger for God's word anywhere outside the borders of this country. It's amazing. We can't get enough scripture sometimes in the different areas that we go. India is a good example. You know, every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl has a decision to make about this Jesus. Your mommy can't make that decision for you. Your daddy can't make that decision for you. And your teacher, standing right over there, cannot make that decision for you. You see, you have to make that decision. He said he was God. In fact, he said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. So every person has this decision to make. He either is who he says he is, or he's, right? He's got to be. You think about it. If after Floyd introduced me and I walked up here and said, congregation, I just want you to know something. I'm God. Just thought I'd get that out of the way. You'd be going, some of you would start heading for the door, right? But that's what he did. Now that was just part of a 3-minute, very hard gospel that I was able to share in Muslim classrooms in Jakarta, Indonesia. One headmaster didn't want us to go in. This was a very large Muslim school, about 4,000 kids. And he said, you don't have an appointment, you come back tomorrow. Now, he said that in Bahasa, but I was told that's what he said. Okay. And what they did, our local Gideons there in Indonesia, where it's very difficult to be a Gideon, it's very difficult to be a Christian in a Muslim nation, they would take us into the places they can't normally get into, hoping that somehow we would be able to talk our way through there. And it typically worked pretty well. But this headmaster would have none of it. You didn't have an appointment, you come back tomorrow. So we did. Came back the next day. And the man said in Bahasa, I want to know what that man from America wants to share with the children. Well, immediately my brothers were very nervous. We hadn't been asked to tell them in advance at other schools. They were very nervous because they'd been hearing me all week share the gospel, right? And so I sensed they're being, you know, very nervous. I said, brothers, you need to translate exactly what I say. exactly what I said. And very tentatively, they did exactly that. And I proceeded to give that 3-minute hard gospel. Now, it'd be a hard gospel for here. Just imagine if you were talking to Muslims about this, right? They think God is a prophet. Jesus is a prophet, right? Well, that's a bit of a paradox. He said he was God. How can it be he'd be a prophet if this is what he says, right? And so I go through this speech, and it ends with me asking, now who among you this morning would like your own personal copy of the most read book in the history of mankind, a copy of God's Word, the Holy Bible? And every child in every room, hands to the sky. 87% of them Muslim. So I proceed to tell this story, and the guy, the headmaster, he's just staring at me. I mean, he's just looking at me, and I'm thinking, we're done. We're out of here. We're thrown out. We're going to get thrown out. And I was okay with it, but you have to tell. Who knows? Maybe we were there just to share Jesus with him. And so he looks and looks and looks. It's probably, I don't know, 20 seconds. It seemed like 20 minutes. He's just staring at me, and then he says something, and all my brothers start to burst. So I knew it was good, but I didn't know what he said. And he said, I want every child in this school to hear what that man just said. Now, I know what I said. I know my brothers translated me exactly upon my admonishment. I don't know what he heard, but I know this. Chuck Smith can't do that. Chuck Smith can't open that door. That is the power of God who opened that door. Amen?
Amen.
And we were able to go in and give every one of them a copy of God's Word. And we were able to do that because you sent us. Who knows what the harvest will be from that 4,000 scriptures that day? Who knows? It's amazing. So, I mentioned you can pray for the Gideons International. Pray that we'll be able to meet that demand. Recently, the Sudan was open to the Gideons. We have camps in Pakistan, Syria, Lebanon, Jordan. And what you won't see us market on our website or talk about much except directly in churches is that the Gideons have a very active ministry in the People's Republic of China. The hunger for God's Word, as I told you, is very enormous, voracious. Pray that the Word will transform those nations. But hear me now. Pray that the Word will transform this nation. You see, we live in a nation that's become the third largest mission field in the world. We live in a nation that needs Jesus. Our intention this year is to distribute 12 million scriptures in the United States alone. Second, I don't think I can give as passionate a plea for you to consider joining the Gideons that Pastor Long did. Pastor Long, thank you so much. Save a little time out of my survey here, or my summary here. But I'll tell you this. This is just one man's opinion. I believe that the reason God has blessed this ministry as it has is obviously because it's about Him. It's about His Word. It's about His glory, right? It's not about us. It's not about Gideon's. It's about Him. But when you work in the local camp of the Gideons International here in Venice, Inglewood area, you impact your local Jerusalem, your Judea, the rest of Florida, parts of the southeast, Samaria, the entire North American continent, and even unto the ends of the earth, as I just shared with you in India, as I just shared with you in Indonesia. And all of that happens as you serve here. It's amazing. I don't know how many ministries are like that, where you impact all of the areas that we're commanded to impact. You know, in Acts 1 and 8, it says, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and even into the uttermost parts of the world. You know, most people do a decent job in their Jerusalem. They do okay, they do some work in Jerusalem. We did a little work in Jerusalem yesterday with Big Mike. But I want you to examine yourself. Are you fulfilling God's purpose for your life? Are you impacting all of those areas in your ministry? If not, certainly Floyd, myself, we'll be able to look forward to listen to your other Gideon brother back there. We would love to chat with you after service. Perhaps you want to become a friend of the Gideon, and we'll give you one of these applications to do that. There's another thing you can do, and I know you all are familiar with Gideon cards. Gideon cards are a wonderful way to share God's word. This is a program we've had for many, many decades, really. But you can use this program beyond the traditional tribute cards that you see here. We've added quite a few cards. One that I like is just praying for you today. I'm just praying for you today. I know you've often had that thought, but when you pray for somebody and then you send Bibles in their honor, you know what's really weird about these things? You will get a card thanking you for your card. That's usually what happens. It's crazy. But I encourage you, and then on the back of each one is a little testimony about how the word impacted a life. And finally, you can support the ministry financially. We're going to take a sacrificial offering for the Gideons at the doors as you leave here. We've strategically placed the Gideon by each door, so it's going to be really hard for you to get out of here without having us. As I mentioned, a case of these scriptures costs $125. I know there are people here today that can write a check at will for the Gideons for $125, buy 100 New Testaments to get distributed. Or we've given you a bulletin insert. If you want to look at these bulletin inserts here, there's a number of different ways that you can pay. You can do it with your smartphone. We've had people make donations while we're up here talking through the code on here. But there's a lot of different ways you can do this. You can take this home. It includes a little envelope here that you can tear off, put your check in. If you didn't come prepared to give today, that's something that you can do, and send your check in to your Lemon Bay, mighty Lemon Bay camp of the Gideons International. Arturo Laredo was in a Texas jail for drug trafficking when the Gideons visited his prison. Their gift to him of a little scripture changed his life. He now stores Bibles where he used to store 2 tons of marijuana. You remember the Boko Haram? That's the group that kidnapped all those little girls in Africa, in Nigeria, right? A sweet soul named Elizabeth was chased from her home when the Boko Haram moved in. It was several months later that the Nigerian forces secured that village so she could go back home. And when she went back home, there was only one thing that had changed about her house. There was a case of Gideon New Testaments in her house. She didn't know how they got there, but she began handing them out. And some of those books ended up into the hands of the Boko Haram. And she reported to us that many of the Boko Haram are now coming to Christ. Only God's word can do that. We're not going to convince somebody of that. Amen? So no one knows how those scriptures got there. No one knows which church paid for those scriptures to be there, but somebody did. David Smith is a police officer in San Antonio, Texas. He's also a Gideon. Every time he arrests somebody, he gives them a copy of God's word. He has seen firsthand the results of treating the problem, and not just the symptom of the problem. We have a pastor at our church who's a state trooper here in Florida. He does the same thing. He has a captured audience every time he's got somebody in the cage back there and they hear about Jesus. Now, I need to apologize for the gratuitous number of pictures of me in this next video. You see, in Indonesia, here's how it happens. Each of our 7 men had 2 teams of indigenous Gideons, Indonesian Gideons, and we would go out with them in the morning. We typically get up at 5 in the morning. We have prayer time at 5 in the morning. We'll go load up our cars and trucks, and then we'll go have a bite of breakfast, and then we go. So all day during the day, I am the only, they called us Europeans, even though none of us were from Europe, one of the Europeans all day long. And so they were taking pictures of me. I was never taking pictures of pretty much anybody else. So there's a lot of pictures of me, and I apologize. And here's what I want you to understand. This is not about me. This is not about the Gideons. I want you to focus on the people of Indonesia. Okay? This is the kind of thing you allow us to do. I want to thank Pastor Ron for allowing the Gideons to share and worship this morning. And I want you to enjoy the video, and we will see you at the doors after the service. God bless y'all.
You're the God of this city.